I know it's middle of the week and everybody's busy, and I really appreciate y'all coming. I wanted to give you a little bit of background about myself so you know where I'm coming from. And I originally started my career off as a professional zookeeper in Providence, Rhode Island. And I got to work with some pretty neat animals, from polar bears to penguins to sea lions, and eventually became a head keeper. And one of the areas that I was managing, I did Australasia, and I did North America, tropics, and the Heritage Breeds Farm. And as some of my former zoo colleagues can attest to, farm animals get a really bad rap among zookeepers because they're not real zoo animals. And for me, that was always really frustrating because of all the zoo animals, the farm animals were the ones that people really connected to. And I loved the way people would respond to them. And I also was never, it never ceased to amaze me how little kids knew about where their food came from. And so, you know, kids would come running into the farmyard and see my Dexter cows and, oh, look at the horses! No, they're not horses. Or, you know, they'd get excited to see a bunny rabbit. They'd never seen a live rabbit before. You know, how sad is that? And so, you know, over the years, I really loved lemurs, but more and more my zookeepers would give me more grief about, we don't want to work in the farmyard, it's punishment. So I'd end up working more and more in the farmyard to give people experience with the other species. And as it turns out, I found that to be the coolest place in the entire zoo, because I not only could spend time with these animals that I found fascinating, I could educate people and feel really good at the end of the day that I was able to reach so many more people than I could with my lemurs or my polar bears. And I thought that was really important. The other observation I made was, you know, our zoo society members that could come back over and over to the zoo as many times as they want, the first place they go would be the farmyard, because they want to know how Eddie the goat's doing or how Winnie the cow is doing. And you know, the funniest story I have on my zoo days is my director, Tony Vecchio. He had a lot of money spent on a new penguin exhibit. I mean, tons of money for our little zoo. And you know, it was black tail and ties, you know, very fancy affair, champagne and strawberries. And so we opened up the penguin exhibit and, you know, we're showing off the penguins. And we soon noticed that there was hardly anybody around the penguin exhibit. And what had happened was people had discovered there were baby ducklings in the farmyard next door. Everybody went to go see the ducklings. So Tony was very upset and he made us shut the doors to the farmyard so everybody would sit in front of the penguins. The point being, people connect with these animals, and that's a really powerful tool. And so when I started talking more about my Dexter cows and my, you know, fainting goats compared to my lemurs and the polar bears, I thought, you know, maybe it's time to retire. And I'm laughing because these are some of my former zoo colleagues from Connecticut. I decided to get into heritage breed conservation. And so it's really funny when I go to zookeeper conferences now to talk about heritage breeds and zoos, and all my old friends will be like, so Jeanette, what are you doing these days? And I'm like, I'm doing heritage breed conservation. And they all have the same face. They're like, oh, that's nice. You know, it's terrible. It's wonderful work. I get very excited about it. So that's a little bit of the background of where I come from. And as you can tell, I'm pretty passionate about what we do. And I hope you will be by the end of this talk. The Livestock Conservancy is a nonprofit that's been around for about 40 years. And so we're 501c3, we're a membership organization. So if you're not a member already, become one. You need to become one. Be part of this movement. We protect nearly 200 breeds of livestock and poultry. That's a big job for us. You know, we try to whittle the list down very methodically, and I'll talk about how we do that. But even whittling that list down, we still got about 200 different breeds we monitor. And we focus in on genetic conservation, and again, I'll explain that a little bit more. But that means we're not just saving things because we're rare. We're saving rare things for a very specific reason, and that's a genetic reason. And we work a lot with farmers directly. I spend a lot of time in the field, and try to connect with farmers to see what are their needs, what kind of help do they need, or learning from them. I document a lot from people that we consider master breeders with their breed, because, you know, as we get new people that want to get involved with these animals, we need to help them to understand how to do it properly. And a lot of these breeds are not going to thrive in the systems that are often taught by most of the ag schools out there. You know, you've got ag schools that have a very strong commercial focus, and there are few that are teaching about heritage breeds, but not many. So there aren't that many people out there that know how to raise these guys and breed them properly. And we're headquartered in Pittsburgh, North Carolina. You might have heard we have a basketball team out there. And we've been around for about 40 years. We protect endangered livestock and poultry breeds from extinction. That's the bottom line, what we do, to put it simply. And we work with all of the typical breeds and species that you would find, well, the typical species you'd find on farms. So, things that would have been on a typical American farm, in the 20th century or earlier. The reason most of these breeds became endangered is because they got outcompeted. They lost their jobs. You know, modern agriculture after World War II, a lot of the soldiers that came back didn't want to go back to the farm. And so, we had to raise a lot of animals in a very short period of time to start feeding all those baby boomers that were being born. And so we went from having really diverse collection of animals on farms to a very few specialized breeds so we could get a lot of food in a short period of time to feed all these people. And the breeds that didn't fit the mold, they basically got outcompeted. So the important thing to think about with these animals is, you know, these breeds, even though they might not grow the biggest and the fastest, they may have some traits that are pretty darn important, like mothering skills, disease resistance, ability to thrive in challenging environments. And, as Carrie Fowler had said so eloquently, is that, you know, we don't know the future, we don't have a crystal ball, and we don't know if we're gonna need these traits at some point in time. So, you know, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. We need to keep these animals around just as an insurance policy for what may come in the future. We don't know what it is, but why take a chance and lose them? Every time we lose a breed, we lose a little bit of genetic diversity. And why does the diversity matter? And, the simplified thing is looking at it like a stock portfolio. And, you know, it's a portfolio. You don't want to put all your money into one thing or all your investment into one thing. You want a diversified investment because if something happens, it won't be, a catastrophe if you know, one of those components is affected because you can fall back on the others. Two really, really good examples. Everybody knows about the Irish potato famine. The reason the famine happened was because everybody was raising the same kind of potato, the lumper. Well, as it turns out, the lumper was susceptible to a disease called the blight, and anybody who raised the lumper was out of the potato business in a very short period of time. The people that raised other varieties didn't get hit as badly. Same exact thing happened with bananas during the 1950s. The entire banana industry was growing the Gros Michel bananas, and it got hit with Panama disease. The entire industry globally was wiped out of bananas. Sound familiar? You know? Are we learning yet? Today we have Cavendish bananas. The entire industry is based on that one banana. And now we have tropical race disease that's going through the banana industry. In a very short period of time, you are not gonna see the Cavendish banana on this shelves anymore. So we never learned from our mistakes. And same thing with potatoes. You know, we got the russet Burbanks. This is the potato where you get all those beautiful uniform McDonald's French fries. It's very vulnerable to diseases right now. And so we have a hard time learning from our mistakes here. So how does that translate to livestock? Well, commercial chickens, not that long ago you may have seen in some of the major newspapers and magazines about woody breast, which sounds pretty gross. You know, these commercial birds, when you process them, you'd have this tough, almost fibrous, woody-like muscle tissue in the birds. And at first it would be white striping in the muscle tissue, and then it would progress to woody breast. And the commercial industry assured us that it wasn't dangerous to human health, and rather than selling chicken breasts, they'd chop it up into chicken nuggets and nobody would be the wiser. Which is, anyway. It turned out it was a genetic problem, because these animals were so highly inbred and were so refined to grow so fast in such a short period of time that this became a genetic problem. Luckily for the commercial folks, they were able to isolate the specific population that were the carriers for the genes that caused this problem, and little by little they've been able to breed it out. But we're talking millions and millions of chickens that were affected by this one genetic trait. So this is like a little red flag going up here that, you know, we might want to have some extra genetics around. Holstein cattle, the Holstein cattle population in America is effectively related to 23 cows. That's it. And two bulls. And I think the two bulls were brothers or related. And, they are starting to have problems. Foot problems, fertility problems, birthing problems. And what are you going to do about that? You know, so who are you going to call? You're going to call Heritage Breeds in. For the broiler industry, you can go back to the original breed that the broiler industry is based on, and that's the Cornish chicken. The Cornish chicken is a superb meat bird. They don't grow particularly fast, or, they do have a lot of meat, but not to the scale of a commercial bird. These guys can still breed naturally. But they contain the genetics that's the foundation for commercial broilers. So it's pretty darn important to keep these guys around. Then you have the Dutch Belt cow, which a lot of the commercial dairy companies are incorporating into their breeding programs. They don't produce as much milk as a Holstein, but they're pretty sound animals. You know, they still have pretty decent fertility. They certainly don't have as many problems as the larger Holstein cattle have. And I'd done a study once to see what could be done with Dutch Belt veal calves, and come to find out that nobody's selling veal calves, and that's because all the bull calves were being bought up by Holstein breeders as grade-up animals. Just interesting little anecdote for commercial cattle. For the bulls that aren't sold as grade-up animals, they can legally be sold as Angus beef because they have enough black on their bodies to be certified Angus. So if you've got Dutch Belt, you believe it or not, you've actually got a premium beef animal, even though they're a completely dairy animal, but go figure. So genetic diversity really means security for our agricultural system. There are a lot of natural advantages to heritage breeds. Some of them are parasite resistance, ease of birthing, good mothering skills. I used to breed marsh tacky horses. These horses, I never heard of anybody colicking unless they got into something poisonous. You could let them run through the woods. They're not going to break their legs on stump holes. As the old timers say, they know how to wear their feet. So, you know, my first foal running through the woods, I just went like this, and sure enough, he was fine. I was more nervous than he was. But they're excellent mothers. And, American buff geese, they grow really, really fast. They're easy keepers. And for a beginner, they're a really easy goose to start with. Rough and tumble are a lot of these breeds are. A lot of them can rise to the challenge of climate change. You've got here these ancient white park cattle in Montana. And they can handle weather extremes. And the other thing they're really good at is protecting their offspring from predators. These animals, up until recently, were hunted as big game. They're very wild. They're not a backyard cow. They're not a cow for beginners. But if you have a place with weather extremes, and then you've got major predators like grizzly bears, mountain lions, wolves, these guys, if you go into a field with ancient white park cattle, the first thing they do is surround their babies like musk oxen. And then that head goes down, and that's where you start to slowly walk away from them. You know, they are not for beginners. But, you know, in this cattle ranch in Montana, they're perfect. and they do very, very well up there. They're great multitaskers. I used to breed Buckeye chickens. This was one of my favorite roosters that, you know, I still get teary-eyed thinking about him dying because he was so useful. He, you know, he not only was really gentle with the females, he actually kept the cockerels in line. So the cockerels that were up and coming and strutting their stuff, the minute they became overly aggressive with the hens, this big guy would come over and trounce on them. Or if those cockerels jumped at me, he jumped at them. His job was to teach them manners and make sure that the hens weren't getting overly stressed out. The other beautiful thing about the Buckeyes is they eat everything. They were eating snakes, they were eating lizards, and I was not going to let my poodle anywhere near because they probably would have eaten him too. This is a 9-pound rooster. My poodle weighs about 7 pounds. So I had them in my front yard one year. I didn't have to cut the grass. They ate all the grass. I sent a lot of eggs to my buddy out in California. I don't know if you know about ground squirrels in California. Wherever his Buckeyes are, he has no ground squirrels. Yeah, that's pretty major. So they're pretty darn useful. So one of the beauties of these heritage breeds is don't just think about the obvious with them. Think about the products and services they can give you. You know, it's just not just meat and eggs. You know, they can tell me when a predator's nearby. They can cut my grass. They can weed my garden. They can cultivate and turn the soil. Although my husband hated it when they were messing with his critical mass in his compost pile. But, you know, they pest control, and that could be, you know, anything from bugs to mice to what have you. And when you add all these things up, that's a real value, you know. The fact that I don't have to pay for gas or take the time to cut my lawn, that's great. So how do we save all these breeds? And we like to call these our nuts and bolts. And so we start with securing the base. And so we try and find these populations that we feel are genetically significant, meaning if they were to disappear, there's no way to recreate that breed because the foundation that was used to create them no longer exists. And that's the bottom line there. So to secure the base, we try to find the animals, and then we try to network the remaining people that have the animals. We do like to encourage breed associations to be formed because it's only when people really start communicating with each other that you're going to be successful with these breeds. And then we help them with promotion and outreach. You know, once you've got these animals secured and you're starting to build up the base and get more numbers, these animals need jobs. And so we try to help them with that, with promotion and outreach. I work with a critically endangered chicken called the Crevecoeur, and these were premier table birds in France since the 12th century. They haven't been on anybody's table since World War II. That's because the Germans almost wiped them out, but also that they kind of got left behind. And so my number one job for the Crevecoeur is to get them back on the table. And people are always stunned. How can you eat your birds? They're so rare. I'm like, A, they're yummy. Two, that's their job. And three, not every bird's meant to be a breeder. So they got to go somewhere. And if you believe these animals are going to survive being a lawn ornament or somebody's pet, that's a fairy tale. It ain't going to happen. They got to have jobs. Next thing is training the next generation. So now we've secured the base, we've started to build market. Now we need more people raising these animals. And because some of these animals can be a little complex to raise, you know, we help train those folks. We've got really great training materials on breeding chickens and breeding and raising turkeys. And we're working on pigs should be out soon. And we're hoping to do so much more to help train folks. You'll see some of the programs we have started for training. And then continued support. You know, when we go out in the field or I go to do a talk like here, it's great that I was invited to come to this talk, and I use this talk as a great excuse to reach out to our members in the area. So I visited Sister Telltale, who I've known about for years and years and years, and she's done lovely work with Dutch Belt cattle, and why haven't I ever visited her before? And I finally visited her for the first time this week, and a few other farms. So we really do try to reach out to our members. So, you know, we want to hear you. We want to know, what do you need from us? What's working for you? What isn't? And hey, do you know any people we should be talking to? Because maybe your neighbor up the road has a chicken or a goat or something that they've had for years and years and years. Like, we found a goat farmer in Florida. His family's had their goats for 100 years. And luckily, we found out as he was sending them all to auction, we were able to get only a small handful, but at least we got a few of them before they all went to auction. Luckily, all the does we got were pregnant, so now we've got double what we had, well, almost triple what we had, and that's something we can work with. But gosh, I wish we had found out before the others went to auction, because that was a genetically distinct bloodline that we really could use in the Southeast, because they're superbly adapted to heat and humidity. But we got there, at least we saved some of that. So if you know of somebody with something interesting, give us a call. You know, and please assure them we're not Big Brother, we're not a government organization, we're just here to help. We had a really good example of a lady out in South Dakota. She had Java chickens, been in her family since the 1930s. And we convinced her that, you know, maybe it's a good idea to get those genetics elsewhere. And so we incorporated some of her eggs into our breeding program. She called us 2 months later crying because a badger had gotten in and killed all her Javas. And if it wasn't for getting some of those hatching eggs into other hands, it wouldn't have been possible to actually eventually send birds back to her. So if you see something unique, call us. We're always on the lookout. Part of securing the base is censusing and developing what we call the conservation priority list. And this is where we rate the breeds from critical to threatened to watch to recovering. And it just gives you kind of an idea of what breeds need the most assistance. If you've never been involved with rare breeds before, I always tell folks, don't jump to critical. Do something in threatened or watch, because critical means they need people that know what they're doing to be involved. And the list is comprised roughly of about 200 breeds, and it's a great starting point to try and figure out what needs help and, you know, what might pique your interest. We do a lot of outreach. We work with, you know, a lot of education, stuff like this seminar. We also help with herd-specific breeding plans. Like right now, we're helping folks with some pig breeding plans. And you know, if you've had a herd and you've been going on for a while and you need to know what direction to go in now, we can analyze your herd and try and come up with some solutions or point you in the direction of people that maybe have genetics that would be complementary to yours. Certainly beginner farmer support we talked about, and direct marketing training. We do at least a couple of marketing seminars every year. We've got materials on our website. And a lot of times you can pick up the phone and just call us, say, geez, you know, I'm having a hard time connecting with chefs in my area. How can I do that? And we're closely linked with like Slow Foods USA, Chefs Collaborative, and a lot of the foodie organizations that are going to be your customers for your products. So a lot of that we do. We also produced a couple of books. This one's just coming out, Managing Breeds. It's my only copy. But this is coming out in May, and this is more of a college text, but it's the only book of its kind that talks about conservation breeding, breeding strategies, how to form a breed association, how to run a breed association. It's really a how-to guide. If you want to take the next step from introduction to advanced, this is going to be the book. Otherwise, we've got a great introduction to heritage breeds. And both of them are available on Amazon or on a website. But really great reads if you're wanting to get serious about heritage breeds. We do a lot with helping breed associations, and there's rarely a week that goes by where some association's not breaking down or melting down. I always summarize it in that people that get involved with heritage breeds, they do so because they don't want to do what everybody else does. And so they're very independently minded people. And as you can imagine, when independently minded people try to work together, problems ensue. So we're really good at being Switzerland, and usually we can work things out. Given time, we can make peace with folks, but it does take time. And the thing is, everybody means well, they're very passionate about their breeds, and we've just gotta very carefully get people to cool their jets and realize fighting with each other is not doing your breed any good. So we've got a pretty good track record with that. We monitor elections, so if there's infighting and, you know, they want a neutral party to count up election ballots, we'll do that for folks, and we do a lot of that. So lots of working with the breed associations. We do a lot of spreading the word. We go to Mother Earth News Fairs. If you've ever been to one or haven't been to one, you need to go to one. They're a blast. The closest ones to you guys, there's one in June up in Vermont, and then in September there's one at Seven Springs, Pennsylvania. But they're a real blast if you want to learn about sustainable ag, sustainable living. We have a lot of heritage breeds that come for exhibit on there, and a lot of talks. We have a lot of livestock talks, and it's a great way to network with folks that are similarly minded to you. But we reach well over 100,000 people a year just through those fairs alone. We do a lot at living history museums and farms, scientific meetings. So we really get out there and try and be part of the bigger conversation. So some of the programs we've done, I wanted to give you an idea of what some of our successes are. Navajo churros, certainly one. When we first got started with them back in the 80s, there were very, very few of them out there. And this is a breed that's been around for about 400 years. They came over with the Spanish colonists. Eventually, they were adopted by the Native Americans and used for fiber arts. And all those fabulous Navajo rugs that you see on Antiques Roadshow selling for like $500,000, they were made with that kind of wool. And the army, in its wisdom, wanted to improve the sheep that was superbly adapted to living on rough forage. They were parasite resistant, easy keepers, regular lambers up until very high ages. Why improve that? You know, they broke, don't fix it. Anyways, a lot of them were wiped out during the 1800s, early 1900s. And they were this close to the brink until we got involved and started networking folks. And then those groups of people went much farther from there and developed a market not only for the textiles but for the meat. And today the churro sheep's doing very, very well. And people are really looking for their fibers. They're very desirable fiber to work for. The fiber art scene's pretty exciting these days because as baby boomers start to retire, a lot of them are looking for hobbies, and a lot of them are going to fiber arts. So for the first time in decades, our members are reporting making money on wool. Wow. That's stunning. Yeah. Horse breeds. Horses are probably the hardest animals we have to conserve. Can't eat them. Although if you talk to my husband, you can, but he's French and they eat everything. So horses are a real struggle for a number of reasons. One, you know, the Horse Slaughter Act has made it so now that there's no place for old horses that are no longer able to be kept or are beyond their reproductive years or have no place to go. It's caused a real glut in horses in America, and the well-meaning people that enacted that have really created a nightmare for the horse in America, and it's really sad, very complex. I could talk about it for an hour. Anyways, it's caused problems for us because there is no incentive for people to breed horses right now because it's hard to sell them. So we're working with breeders to start working on markets for the horses. In the meantime, we're trying to secure genetics. Some of the successes recently, the Marsh Tacky horse, when we got involved with them in 2006, there was only about 150 of them. And at the time, we had thought they were extinct. But we had a couple of Florida Cracker horse people that called up our advisor, Phil Sponenberg, who's standing there. And he said, Phil, you know, there's some really interesting horses in South Carolina you guys need to look at. And we think they're Spanish. And so I was able to convince Phil to get out of Virginia Tech, let's go to South Carolina. And lo and behold, we went there, and sure enough, they look like Spanish horses. And when we DNA'd them, they do come from Spanish foundation. And the population as a whole seems to have been, when we looked at the DNA, this was a breed. So we were able to network the breeders, which was a real challenge because in South Carolina, family feuds run deep. And there are a lot of people that weren't talking to each other. And so I came in as the newbie, and because they're extremely polite, they weren't going to yell at me or drag me into stuff. So I was able to start mending the fences, and we got a breed association started and started cultivating a new generation of breeders. So we went from 150 horses to now we've got about 320, maybe 350, but we're well on our way with the breed. So they're doing quite well, and I think we've got enough diversity that they're going to be sustained. Choctaw horses, anybody seen the movie Hidalgo? No? Mm-hmm. Yeah, a few people, you know, at the end, they let the horses roam free. They're going to live their lives forever on Blackjack Mountain. Well, they got kicked off the mountain 8 years ago. And the grazing lease was canceled. And it wasn't because of the horses. It was the cattlemen that really ticked off the landowner. And he said, everybody off the mountain. And so we had a very short period of time to get 300 horses off the mountain. And by some miracle, we literally pulled a rabbit out of hat and got funding to be able to help us to buy traps and start gathering these horses and getting them off the mountain. And we were able to get just about all of the 300 horses out of there. They went on to private ranches. And then we started working on finding conservation breeders for these animals. We've got a significant herd in Northern Virginia now, and they are kicking butt in Northern Virginia because the owner is doing a really smart thing. First of all, she's getting a bunch of little kids that belong to rich people, rich individuals, to fall in love with these ponies. And these horses are doing dressage, they're doing fox hunting, they're doing competitive driving, they're doing hunter pace. Some of them are even slated to start playing polo. And she's not going to be able to sell any of these horses until they have a job. And she's doing a really, really good job. And the unexpected thing is, going back to baby boomers, a lot of these older ladies that are on, you know, 16, 17 hand thoroughbreds, when they see these 14 hand Choctaws can do the same job and eat a third of the food, and they're not foundering, they've got good feet, they're well-mannered, they're smart, and they want to be with you, all of a sudden they're pretty darn attractive. And so a lot of the older ladies are now looking at these Choctaws, and they're phenomenal when you've got them all groomed up, and you know, they're every bit as beautiful as any 17 hand thoroughbred, and they're a heck of a lot less trouble. So the Choctaw's starting to build a name for itself, but that's only one small niche in Northern Virginia, and it's not going to save the Choctaw with just that one project. But it's a great model for others. And with the Marsh Tackies, they're doing the same thing in South Carolina. They're now going to a lot of the fairs. They've been declared the heritage horse of South Carolina. So now the whole state knows what a Marsh Tacky is. So these are some really great success stories. The Wilbur Cruz horses, they're a ranch strain from New Mexico. And out there, they're doing pretty good because they're very sure-footed. And if you're on rocky terrain and you don't want your horse to be tripping up or putting you into a dangerous situation where it might fall or stumble, a Wilbur Cruz is going to be a really great pick for you out there. The other thing we encourage is, if you're going to get a horse that, you know, one of these horses that's adapted to your climate. So I get people calling from like Minnesota that want a Marsh Tacky. I'm like, no, you don't want a Marsh Tacky. You want something that's going to be adapted for your climate. And so we'll look at horse strains that are more northerly and can handle the cold better than some of these others. Dutch Belt cattle, when we got involved with them years and years ago, we had a very small population, and the Conservancy started it took over a stud book for them and had a very successful time managing the stud book. And it was so successful that now the Dutch Belt Association took over that stud book, and they seem to be doing well, although in having discussions just the other day, they're not doing as well as we thought. And it was really great that we have this conversation, because we haven't been hearing through the grapevine that heifers are pretty hard to come by these days. And that's not a good sign. So we're going to be doing a little more investigation with Dutch Belt. The interesting thing about these animals is, because we have a healthy population in the U.S., we're actually able to help the Dutch repopulate this breed back in their own country, because during World War II, most of the Dutch Belt were eaten. And so because we were able to export semen, the Dutch now are able to recover their own breed, and numbers are growing. Turkeys, everybody has heard about heritage turkeys now. You know, back in the early 90s, nobody was eating them. And when we found out with the census there were only 1,300 breeding birds of all the varieties combined, that was a major red flag, and we had to jump into action pretty quickly. And that was another one where we had to find what was left out there, who had them, network those folks, and start cultivating a new generation of breeders, because the problem was there just wasn't enough people breeding them. And today, you're finding them in Whole Foods. You can find heritage turkey. You still have to order them in advance, you know, way in advance of Thanksgiving. But if you want one, you place your order in August, and you're sure to have one. Not that long ago, that wasn't possible. So that's a really great success story. Although, you know, we did the census last year, and some of them are starting to slip again. So it's always important to be vigilant because, you know, you might think everything's going really great, but like when we did our census, we're noticing bourbon red turkeys are slipping. Not sure why, but we need to get on the ball with cultivating some more people to raise bourbon red turkeys. Chickens, I spent a ton of time working on chickens because of the backyard chicken movement. And one of the projects I'm particularly proud of was our Buckeye Recovery Project, because it basically set up a model that can be used to recover any chicken breed. And I'm not talking just numbers, I'm talking productivity. The only way the Buckeye chicken is so popular today as it is because through this project, we took birds that were critically endangered and all over the place. I mean, look at these two birds, same sex, same age, same breed. That bird on the left is a miserable specimen, tiny head, itty bitty bird, and then you got this big, robust, beautiful bird on the right. By the end of the program, they were all looking big and robust. So we were creating really nice, big, productive birds that met breed standard, and our goal was to get cockerels at 6 pounds by the age of 16 weeks. For anybody that's raised heritage breeds, that's pretty damn impressive. And we did it. We got them to that size. But it took about 10 years. The Krebs will get there. Yeah, well, eventually. So it was important in setting up a model. And the thing was, we weren't reinventing the wheel. All we were doing was reintroducing people to the wisdom of things like The Call of the Hen. This was a book published in 1914 by Walter Hogan. And it is a superb book on breeding chickens. And what we did was take the information in there and modernize it, translate it into modern terms, get a lot of photographs of the project so that people could see both feathered birds and naked birds, what we're talking about, and be able to take these methods, and you could use it for any chicken breed. So it was really, really a great project that had long-term repercussions. It's really gratifying to go to an American Poultry Association meeting now, and people are talking about production selection. 10 years ago, they were never talking about that. And it's so important to give these chickens some other job besides being a show chicken. The breed I work with, the Crevecoeur, the reason they're in such miserable shape is people stopped eating them. And they became just show birds. And yes, they're pretty and they're cute. Again, that's not going to solidify their long-term survival like that. We work a lot with the American Poultry Association. If you're into poultry, you really should be a member of this group. They're the ones that they basically established the standards for all poultry breeds. And they helped us with our poultry census a couple of years ago. And that was a really important partnership for us. And what was really surprising is we got funding from a commercial hatchery to do it. And one thing we're getting really good at is reaching out to the commercial folks to get them to understand that, okay, maybe you don't think what we're doing is important now, but at some point in time, what we're doing is going to be important to your business. And, you know, when you talk about things starting to affect their business, they pay attention. And of all people, Murray McMurray put up the money for us to do a poultry census. So that was pretty significant for a good number of reasons, but that's probably the most important. We do a lot of rescues like that herd in Florida. We had the low country goats, and these were goats that, you remember I told you, if you see something that's interesting and give us a call. Well, one of my marsh tacky buddies called me up one day and was like, Jeannette, I saw these goats on this island. I think you should come take a look at them. And so I went over there and looked at them, and sure enough, they're old-fashioned Spanish goats. And I met with an old-timer that lived across from the island, and he's like, oh, yeah, they've been out there for about 50 years. I know the guy that put them out there. He passed away about 25 years ago, and they've just been out there. And I'm like, well, you know, these are pretty important. So through him, we were able to reach the island owner and get permission to take some of them off the island. Unfortunately, we weren't able to get all of them off the island, which I was hoping, because somebody got the bright idea to put pigs out there. Big pigs eat baby goats. So they went from having about 200 goats to, last time I was out there, they had about 25. So the locals were convinced we were stealing all the baby goats. And I'm like, no, it's the pigs and the alligators. But we were able to get a bunch of the goats off, and we partnered with Brook Green Gardens over in Myrtle Beach. And Brook Green now has a beautiful little breeding herd, and we have way more off-island than on-island, to the point where every year we're starting to take these goats and put them into the hands of new breeders. And we've probably went from having, I think we started with 10 low country goats, we've probably now got a couple hundred. So they've been doing really, really well, and we've been crossing them with other strains of southeastern Spanish goats, because obviously we're going to run into inbreeding problems with these guys. But they're an important resource. The other neat thing is they have a color that we haven't seen in years called moon spots. And this doe's one of my favorites. They call her Moon Glow. And she's tri-colored, and those spots are tan. You can't see it so good here, but the spots are tan and white, and then you've got the black and the brown. And the old timers call that a moonspot goat. And we haven't seen that color pattern in a long time. And that color pattern is actually dominant in the low country goats. So we've got a whole bunch of moonspot goats now, which is pretty cool. Horses, more horse stuff. We've been doing a gait study. And so what's been really interesting is we thought we knew it all about certain breeds. Well, we didn't. You know, we started looking at the way these horses moved. And the more we look at it, the more we discovered that not only are they genetically unique, but a lot of these horses have gaits that are so unique, they are only found in that particular breed, which is pretty interesting if you happen to be a horse geek. And the other thing was, a lot of these colonial Spanish horses that have been isolated in certain types of environments for a long period of time, it turns out their gaits evolved along with them to give them certain advantages in certain terrains. So, for instance, marsh tacky horses have a gait that actually helps them from getting stuck in the mud. They're swamp horses, you know, and their gait, they have more foot in motion in any given time, and it really helps them from getting stuck in the mud. And, you know, the Wilbur Cruz horses, they're really sure-footed. They've got more foot on the ground, which makes sense because they come from rocky terrain. There's a lot of mountains and cliffs and things, and so they really need to be very sure-footed. And their gait is conducive to sure-footedness. And, you know, Irish draft horses, they're interesting. They're thinking that the gaits are very similar to some of the older British breeds, you know, the hobby horses. And they want to do some more studies with them. We've done Occultechies. I'm currently working on Cleveland Bay. But it'll be really interesting to see how the British breeds relate to each other. But Irish draft was a lot of fun to get, just because it's so pretty to look at when they're running. But this is with Mississippi State University, and we've been doing this for over 10 years now. So we're accumulating really good data on all the different rare breed horses. Sometimes we give opportunities for people to get their hands dirty, and this was our first opportunity. We had an in-the-field work weekend, and we weren't sure how it was going to work out. But we needed to set up breeding pens for Choctaw horses. I got horse on the brain now. Choctaw hogs. And so we needed to fence in 10 acres in a weekend. And so we invited our local members to come to Antlers and, you know, let's have a work party. And the owner of the property provided refreshments and food, and we were lucky to get a lot of the supplies from Tractor Supply. And we made a heck of a pig fence around that 10 acres in very short order. And all kind of folks showed up, including this gentleman in his chuck wagon. He lives on this chuck wagon. I don't know how we found out about it, but him and his son showed up that weekend. And we had a great time, and this was the very first conservation breeding herd of Choctaw hogs. We started out with about a half a dozen of them, and I think we're up to 40 now over there, which is pretty cool. We're doing a lot of DNA studies. We've got a chicken study that's underway right now. I'm doing a lot of blood collection. When I'm in the field visiting farms, I'm usually carrying needles with me, so beware. If you got chickens, I'd love to get blood. So we're trying to compare the different chicken breeds to how they relate to each other, because part of the problem with chicken conservation is chicken breeders have a habit of crossbreeding chickens to develop new colors or to improve their chickens. And so our question is, how many of them are actually the old breed they once were? So we're just starting into that. With turkeys, we're comparing domestic turkeys with the different subspecies of wild turkeys throughout the country. And we're also getting a lot of village turkey samples from Mexico, which is real exciting. So it's going to be interesting to see how the Mexican birds compare to the American birds and then compare those with all the wild subspecies. So kind of cool stuff, but beware if you have turkeys or chickens. I do come with needles. We've been doing a lot of stuff with pigs, and we work quite a bit with the USDA National Animal Germplasm Program. For those of you that aren't familiar with it, that is the largest germplasm collection in the world for livestock. And it's been around since the 1950s, and it's a USDA program, and we do house our Livestock Conservancy collection there. And we're very actively working with them to increase that collection. And recently, we had done a study on a DNA study on pig breeds and discovered our British breeds are in a big trouble right now. They're facing some genetic bottlenecks. So we were able to get funding to be able to make an import of semen from the UK. And we were really fortunate to renew our relationship with Rare Breed Survival Trust. It's our counterpart in the UK. And they were really keen on collaborating on this together because they're facing some of the same bottlenecks we are. So their hope is once we use the semen and get some really good males on the ground, then we can collect semen from those offspring and send that back to the UK. And that's the first time we've ever had this kind of reciprocity with the Brits in a very, very long time. And that is crucial to securing British breeds here in the U.S. So we're really excited. We're going to make this work. If it works for the pigs, we'll be able to make it work for other breeds. We're going to probably need to make more imports. USDA wants to have at least six boars from each breed into the tanks. So we've only got two of large black and gloss road spots right now. So we got a lot of way to go. But if this is successful, then we can go to the grant makers to be able to do more imports. This is a fun project. We kind of stumbled upon some populations in Hawaii, and we think these animals actually go back to the Vancouver expeditions in Hawaii. And they phenotypically look pretty darn interesting, both the sheep and the goats. Not all of them. Some of the sheep in Hawaii are obvious mouflon crosses, but these particular populations here look very different, and they've got a very specific phenotype, and they would have been the kind of sheep found back then. So we've had initial meetings. Originally, it was really hard to reach the Native Islanders on these because they thought we were the Nature Conservancy. And Nature Conservancy likes to eradicate livestock. They don't want to keep livestock in wild areas. You know, they've got good reasons in some cases. But for the Native Islanders, these animals are super, super important hunting resources. And they'll be damned if they're going to let anybody eradicate their animals. And so we first had to get them to understand, no, that's not what we're about. And we were fortunate, one of our board members happened to be going on vacation in Hawaii, and much to the chagrin of his wife, he spent most of the time going after sheep and goats for us. And he's a British gentleman, very charming, and he charmed everybody over there, so he's assured them we're not the Nature Conservancy, we don't want to take away their animals. And so we certainly need more investigation. We'd love to get DNA samples from these animals so we can prove what we think they are, and then get a really concerted effort to get some of them out of the wild and placed into farm situations so they're secure, but also manage those feral populations so that they're at a level where people like Nature Conservancy aren't freaking out about it. So it's a very complex project, very long-term project, very expensive, because as you can imagine, trying to explain to somebody, hey, can you give me money to go to Hawaii? that's a hard sell. But very interesting project, and well worth our time if we can get down there again. We do a lot of documenting of stories. So, you know, this was a great one where I got invited to come down to Mississippi to videotape the stories of the people that were the last cowboys to manage livestock on the open range. And that was a really humbling experience because that's a very close community. And to have an open door to come in and hear their intimate stories about what life was like was humbling and a lot of fun. And as you can imagine, the stories were pretty colorful. And I'm hoping to take all the videotape and produce like a little mini documentary kind of thing on what it was like to manage the animals on open range. And what was interesting is the little kids, like this is my friend Billy Frank Brown, and that's his great niece and nephew, and they never heard the stories before. So it was pretty neat for them to rediscover what their family history was with all these breeds. And Billy Frank's farm is one of the last ones that have the old Gulf Coast sheep and the Piney Woods cattle. So the kids really got excited about it. We're hoping that cultivation is starting and maybe they'll want to continue. We're doing International Heritage Breeds Week. You zoo people should be celebrating that. It originally was National Heritage Breeds Week, and then all our international counterparts found out about it, and they're like, hey, we want to do that. And so last year we went international, and this year we're going to do it again. And so we're coordinating efforts between our organizations, like our group, Rare Breeds Canada, Rare Breeds Survival Trust, Rare Breeds Australia. We're all releasing our conservation priority lists at the same time, and trying to work together to promote this and promote each other. So we're real excited about that. We do a lot of international outreach through our technical advisor, Phil Sponenberg. What's really exciting is that things are turning around in Latin America, and almost all of the conservation programs that are happening in Latin America are based on our work. And it's really cool. You know, Phil is like a god when he goes down there, and they listen to him. And as a result, a lot of the breeds that were really on the brink are secured down there, and we're real excited about that. So we're doing a lot of work. Phil, he was in Paraguay last year. Bolivia and Argentina. And a lot of exciting things are happening. Our executive director was quite humbled when she was asked to help write a CAST paper on protecting gene pools. And that's something that it sounds kind of boring, but it's actually very exciting for us as an organization, because that gives us a voice in a piece that's going to be used for legislation, you know, making decisions on legislation. And so we're able to ensure that some of the issues surrounding rare breeds is going to get into that paper and then get in front of our legislators. Hopefully they'll listen. I don't know these days, but it could be, very significant for the future of rare breeds. All right, so now we get into the point, what can you guys do in Connecticut? There are a lot of things. I was pretty amazed at what everybody was doing on their own in Connecticut, and I think you guys can work together to do so much more. I did want to point out Judy Wallen, who's probably hiding in the back somewhere. Judy helped arrange all this along with Stacy, and she has brought me on a whirlwind tour of Connecticut farms and into New York. And we've connected with our members here and really had a blast. But there's some really neat stuff going on. And you all, there's so many things you could be doing beyond that. And I wanted to give you some ideas, you know, think about how you can promote these breeds. Certainly encouraging new stewards. If you've been working for a breed for a while, don't be afraid to share stock and expertise. I've got so many people that just, you know, I've got a good friend who has been raising Rhode Island Reds and Brahmas in California for years and years and years. Has some of the finest Rhode Island Reds and Brahmas in the country. Will he sell you any? No. Why not? What if a fox hits you, you know? So, you know, don't be afraid to share stock. You know, promote your breeds at fairs. This is my Crevecoeur chicken, Colbert. He is a rock star. And that's because he's a very sweet bird that anybody can handle. Everybody takes selfies with him. That's typical Colbert. He'll just sit on your shoulder and love it. He's eye candy for the camera. And he's a great ambassador. You know, if you do have rare breeds and you are going to go to fairs and stuff, think about getting an ambassador for your flock. Like Colbert, I don't need to breed him anymore. And because he's nice, he doesn't need to go in the stew pot. And so he's got a job. And if something happens to him, at least it's not going to impact my breeding program. And I've got we got one of our board members, Rick Blaney. He has Galiseno horses, and he has two of his Galisenos that go all around the country promoting the breed on behalf of, you know, his farm. And they're great ambassadors. So if you're going to promote your breeds, make sure you've got an animal that's going to really make your breed shine. And, I get calls all the time for eggs and breeding stock now because people know Colbert and they see him on the web. And I started a Facebook page even for the project. The other thing is know your breed inside and out. And if you get me talking about Crevecoeurs, you're in for at least a half hour information because I just love them. I'm excited about them. Get that way about your breeds because it's infectious and people love the stories. So you can do that. You can help with training the next generation. We're always looking for sites to do service to stewardship workshops. These are workshops that are specifically designed with veterans in mind. And what's really great is when you get a group of vets together, they really connect with each other. And this is one of those workshops that form lasting relationships among the participants because they share their service in common. And we've done four of them now. And what's really exciting is these students have become the trainers. And a lot of our former students have come back to now teach the next workshops. So if you have a great idea for a place to hold one of these, certainly give us a call and we can help you set it up. These tend to be very hands-on, on-farm type workshops. So it's better if it's in a place where there are farms nearby so people can really get their hands dirty and get a real feel for what it's like to work with these animals. Using these breeds as educational tools, I love getting rare breeds in colleges. I was just at E.O. Smith High School this morning, and I'm wondering, why the heck don't they have heritage chickens over there? They've got these Banthes and all kinds of mixed breeds, and, you know, they should have heritage breeds there. We have Central Carolina Community College, and I talked him into Delawares, and as you can see, he loves his Delawares. And they're a great teaching tool. You know, they've got potential as a broiler. You know, we pick them because, you know, they've got an interesting history. They're a little bit faster growing, which is interesting for the college. They're a great dual-purpose bird. A lot of folks use them for eggs. And we use this flock as a teaching tool. So one, we'll hatch out chicks for them. They get the chicks and they brood the chicks. All the students learn how to brood and take care of youngsters. They grow them out. And then I'll go in around August, September, and we'll use them as a flock evaluation group. And so each student will get hands-on on how to pick which of these birds is going to stay around as a breeder next year. And then the ones that we don't pick will either go off as pets to the students or they'll get eaten. But it's a useful flock, it's got purpose, and it's a great teaching tool for the students. So it's been a really great program. We've had birds out there now for about 9 years, and the students love it. So it's a great teaching tool. We do chicks in the classroom. So I was approached by our local extension agent who was working with the local schools. They have an embryology requirement in second and fourth grade. And so what they do is get eggs from the local university to hatch out. Problem is, it's a research flock. So once they're hatched out and have chicks, they have to euthanize the chicks because they're part of a study and they're proprietary. And so that didn't really sit well with the extension agent. So I happen to be good friends with one of our extension agents, and he suggested to the 4-H leader, hey, give the Livestock Conservancy a call and see if they have breeders in the area that would work with you. And so we were able to connect local breeders to provide hatching eggs to the schools, and when the chicks hatch, they just come back to the farm they came from. The great thing is it was really exciting for the teachers because it's not only talking about embryology, it's talking about biodiversity, it's talking about breed conservation, talking about breeds, it's talking about history, it's talking about breeding, proper breeding. And I mean, you can only go into so much detail with the second grader, but it made a lot more exciting for the teachers now. We produced a coloring book, so the kids got coloring books that showed the wide diversity of body types that chickens have. And to date, we've probably reached about 8,000 kids. And they're excited. And what's really exciting is when the school analyzes those kids and the effect of the program, first of all, absenteeism while this hatching thing's going on goes way, way down. Their science grades go way, way up. And all these kids have all of a sudden started thinking, geez, maybe I want a career in science someday. They're really excited. You know, they have to keep notes. They have to track temperature and humidity. They have to weigh the chicks. They have to keep the chicks separate because when I come in to toe punch the chicks, I need to pedigree them. And, you know, and I show the kids how to toe punch. And that's pretty exciting because they think, you know, I'm going to kill the chicks. But, you know, when you explain, this is what you need to do to be a responsible breeder. And I was talking earlier, little kids tend to terrify me. I have a hard time relating to them, but you know, my daughter, who's got mad skills with kids, she said, Mom, it's all about shock and awe. And so I'm like, all right, so how can I shock these kids? Well, first of all, I thought I'd start teaching them to toe punch, because, you know, toe punch, yeah. And so that got them all worried that I was going to hurt the chickens. And once I showed them my, you know, what it is, and then pulled out my toe punch chart, and they're like, oh, that's pretty cool. And I pulled out Colbert and talked about what a great chicken it is. And I said, you know, he's got a purpose, and every bird on my farm has to have purpose. And how many have been chased by a mean rooster? And of course, everybody's got their stories. And I said, you know what we do with mean roosters around my place? We eat them. There's that awe again. And all of a sudden, you know, people are so worried about letting kids know where their food comes from. And at first I thought, oh, the kids are going to freak out. But my daughter was right. You grab their attention, and if you don't make a big deal out of it, I said, we eat them and we like them. I love my chickens, but they got to have a job. What do you think is in the supermarket? Chicken. This is a chicken. This is where food comes from. And they're okay with it. I think it's more the parents get worked up about it. But, you know, give kids a chance. They really don't freak out at all. So this is something you can do around here. Go meet with your 4-H extension. This is a science requirement in schools. So if you've got a breeding flock and you'd like a nice big batch of chicks hatched out, this might be a great way for you. If you're worried about biosecurity, what I do is every classroom has one set of eggs from one farm, and that's it. No cross-contamination from the other farms. The kids are trained how to wash their hands, and it's very biosecure. All the chickens that are going to the program have to be MPIP certified flocks, meaning they're tested for salmonella-related diseases, so that we're pretty sure that they're healthy flocks. And I even go further, each room has a different bloodline. So I can go in and toe punch my birds and pedigree them so I can bring them into my breeding program. So it's worked really, really well. We expanded to another county this year in North Carolina and doubled our reach in North Carolina. We now have folks in Virginia. We've got a group up in Vermont that wants to do it. But this is something you guys can do in Connecticut pretty easily. Historic food events. This has been a lot of fun lately. When you connect history with the food that people eat, and specifically the breeds, people get really excited about that. We did this event at the Steeplechases at Montpelier in Virginia, and they have a paddock party every year. And it's this big party before the steeplechase on Saturday. And they typically have about 150, 200 people. It's a la-di-da event, $150, $200 a ticket. And we introduced the idea of serving meat and cheese products from animals that are around during the time of the founding fathers. Pretty neat concept. It was all the rage, and they ended up having to add another tent, and they had 350 people and sold out because everybody was curious about this. They had never thought, you know, Tamworth pork, this is the same pig that maybe James Madison was eating, you know, and so now you're connecting them with history and the flavors of history. We recently did similar at the Autry Museum of the American West where, okay, it's not a historical property, but a lot of the animals that are depicted in their art are animals we work with. So we came up with a couple of food events out there that were a smash hit because we not only connected them with history, but now we're getting them to look at art in a different way. So no longer is it, you know, this, you know, Native American on a pony. It's Native American on a colonial Spanish horse or a Choctaw horse. And what was really neat was we had, we worked with some Santa Cruz horses that were on an island off the coast of California. And they're itty-bitty colonial Spanish horses that were brought over as ranch horses in the 1800s. And the guy who is working with them over at Thousand Oaks, he had his trainer start to work them in the old vaquero style training, horse training. And the guy had a collection of antique bits that he was never able to use because they never fit any of the horses he was riding. He's riding big quarter horses. Well, he started working with these Santa Cruz horses, and guess what? The bits fit. And it's like, of course they fit. These are the horses that the vaqueros were riding, these itty-bitty little Spanish horses. And then when I showed pictures of the antique bits to the curator at the museum, he says, hey, we got those in our collection. I'm like, uh-huh, okay. So, you know, it's really exciting to work with museums and get them to see their art in a different light. At Rinalda House, I was there a few months ago, and they were looking at all this abstract art, and there was one piece of art that they were fretting over, and there was itty-bitty little figures in the background, and they were all debating, are they sheep or are they goats? You know, that's the big debate. And I look at it, I'm like, well, I can tell you. They're goats. Tail up goats, tail down sheep. End of story. Duh. You know, well, you know, that was a revelation to them because now they can interpret their art a little bit differently. So that's another thing. You know, go to your local museums and take a look at the art. And I bet you can probably tell them a little bit more about the art that they didn't know because a cow is a cow to them, a chicken is a chicken. But now, you know, you could talk about that's a Piney Woods cow in Charleston, you know, pulling an ox cart or you know, it's just, it's a lot of fun, especially if you happen to be a history geek like I am. So anyways, these are other events you could do. We were talking about the Mark Twain House the other day. Mark Twain went on and on about his respect for the mighty Minorca chicken. Wouldn't it be cool to serve Minorca eggs at the Mark Twain House for breakfast or something like that? So, you know, stuff like that you can do here. Media outreach. You know, we had our local radio station today. We had a blast. you know, do talking about heritage breeds and stories. So the media loves us. You know, did anybody see that viral video about that giant Brahma chicken? Oh my God. All right, if you Google Brahma chicken, the first thing that comes up is Livestock Conservancy. Well, everybody called us on that. And we were just inundated for a week on that silly chicken. And everybody thought that it was the size of a small child. And then when we told them, you know, it's only about, you know, yay big, which is still a pretty considerable chicken. It was mayhem. But the fact was that all of these news agencies were calling us for information, which was pretty exciting. But, you know, you can reach out to your local stations to, you know, tell your story and be able to get them excited. Or writing. If any of you have writing skills, you know, we get calls all the time for people wanting articles. If you want to publish an article in Hobby Farms or get your pictures out there, we can help connect you with those folks because they are always hungry for articles. Or at the very least, write an article for our newsletter. They're hungry for that kind of stuff. So if you can write, call me. Be a member. You know, we're a membership organization. If you get excited about this stuff and want to meet more people, become a member. And always donate. We're a nonprofit. We're probably the hardest working nonprofit in North America. And we work really, really hard to make sure most of the donations go towards programs and affecting change for the people and the animals. We work very, very hard, but it's really rewarding work. We all love our jobs. If you're looking for a job at the Livestock Conservancy, you're probably going to wait a while. We don't have too many openings very often because we just don't leave. But it's well worth your time and resources. So I will leave it open to questions right now. And I think we're doing okay for time here. Does anybody have any questions? Don't get me off that easy. Yes?
I had white midget turkeys. And I had them for several years. I had so much trouble hatching the eggs. I was just wondering, what we ended up doing was sticking them under a broody chicken. And I was just wondering if you had any tips on hatching heritage breed turkey eggs.
Diet. Good diet. Putting them on a good diet at least a month before you start collecting eggs for hatching. It's like night and day. And unfortunately, most of the commercial diets that are out there are formulated for commercial birds. And typically, they're not formulated. Like, especially chickens. I know you're talking turkeys, but yeah. Like layer diet. All it gives is the minimal amount of nutrition for producing an egg. It has nothing to do with helping with fertility and hatchability. So I would put your birds on a really good vitamin supplement if you're not able to get a high-quality breeding diet, which is going to be kind of hard. Most folks do like custom formulations, but if you can get a really good vitamin supplement, or if you can get like Fertrel makes a really good poultry Nutribalancer that you can mix in with the food, and get them on that for at least a month before you start hatching. And like when I did that with chickens, I went from like 50 to 60% hatchability up to 85. So, but it's a little tricky. But that's one of the little things that the feed companies don't tell you. And the nutritionist for Purina goes running whenever I come into the room because I always like, so how does that affect hatchability? It's just like, see you later. Did you have a question?
Well, I was curious about your organization. You do all kinds of stuff in so many places. What is your budget? What's your membership and budget?
Well, we have a membership of about 2,500 people, and we're hoping to grow that. It's actually on the upswing now, which is pretty exciting. I think when the economy tanked, we were hit a little bit, but it's really starting to go up a bit, and our budget's under $1 million. We're not a big office. I'm the only full-time programs person there. We have a part-time programs person, and then our director, who used to be our programs director, she still does a bunch of program stuff on top of being the executive director. So we're really good at multitasking. Judy, did you want to weigh in on?
Yeah, I just wanted to say thank you for that question because it's a really important one. And I'm going to see a show of hands who all is a member here tonight. All right, big hand for those that are members. Yay! And I wanted to add that you're taking memberships at the back. You sign up and pay tonight to get $10 off your membership. It's normally $45, it goes to $35. That's a nice savings. And that is one way that you can make a difference right now. Mm-hmm. And if you're already a member, you want to buy a gift membership for someone, same deal.
Yes, yeah, so we're a little organization, but you know, through we have a brilliant board that helps us with a lot of stuff, and you know, like going to Hawaii, we can't afford to go to Hawaii, but our board member could, so he was able to take direction and be able to ask the right questions in order for us to get the right data from there. But, yes.
How do we get in touch with people that might be growing the same breeds we are?
Well, we've got our online breeders directory, mm-hmm. so you can go on to livestockconservancy.org and find the breeders through there. But there are a lot of people that aren't joiners, and mm-hmm. so if you're still not finding people, you can call the office, and you know, we probably know somebody that knows somebody. You know, a lot of those chicken people, they're not joiners. So, but you know, I talk with a lot of people, so we can find. I got a phone call from a veteran, you know, a guy he's about to leave the army. He called me from Afghanistan, looking for Malay chickens because he wanted Malay chicks in the springtime when he gets discharged, and made a few phone calls and found a Malays. So none of our members had them, but. You know, we're pretty networked and know people. Yeah. Yes.
What's the process to be added as like a breeder on your directory?
You just join.
Just join.
Yep. If you join, you fill out the paperwork and tell us what you're breeding and tell us what products too. You know, some people they might not sell hatching eggs, just eating eggs. And but also be patient because when people go to the breeder's directory, they don't always read everything and. So even though you're only selling eating eggs, they'll be calling for hatching eggs. And but the breeder's directory is a great way. We also have online classifieds. If you're a member, you can.